We have come together to give thanks and honour a departed friend and to dispose of our fear of the mortal body and to show sympathy with the bereaved. We believe that those who die in Christ share eternal life with Him. Therefore, in faith and hope, we offer our prayer and thanksgiving and trust to God. In the time of care that we live in, we recall the certainty of our own coming death and judgment, and we proclaim that Christ is risen, that those who believe in Him will rise with Him, and that we are united with them in Him. Let us pray together the opening prayer. Loving God, You alone are the source of life. May Your life-giving Spirit flow through us and fill us with Your compassion, one for another. In our sorrow, give us the power of Your peace. Kindle our hope and let our grief be great and joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I am the resurrection and life, says the Lord. He who believes in Me, though he die, yet shall he live. Whoever lives and believes in Me shall never die. Jesus said, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And from St. Paul's Epistle to the Romans, I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depths, nor anything else in creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And we sing together the hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. say together the Christmas word, Son. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore can I lack nothing. He shall feed me in green pasture, and lead me forth beside the waters of comfort. He shall deliver my soul, and bring me forth in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. For I will walk about in the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff comfort me. Thou shalt prepare a table before me against them that trouble me. Thou hast anointed my head with oil, and my cup shall be full. But thy loving kindness and mercy shall abide me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A reading from St. John's Gospel, chapter 14. Jesus, the way to the Father. Do not be worried and upset, Jesus told them. Believe in God and believe also in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I am going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you this if it were not so. And after I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am. You know the way that leads to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can you know the way to get there? Jesus answered him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me. Hear the words of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We live in troubled times. It's interesting, maybe even born at the end of the Spanish flu era, the last major pandemic to affect this nation. And here he goes in the middle of the next one, departing the scene. A bit of humour in that. Because we all know we're here to say goodbye to him. And there's three reasons for holding a Christian funeral. To be sad together, to be thankful together, and to be hopeful together. People who are both grieved and naturally empty, they're sad. So many things they've hoped for together, so many things they've done. And there's so many ways of showing their love to each other, which perhaps will not always be possible. Loss, loneliness, anger, depression, confusion are all natural when people die. But gradually it is possible to be stirred, sowing to normality, if you want to put it like that, and support those who grieve. For all who knew and know many, this day is a day of sadness, but also day filled with joy. Because let's be honest, you get to 99, you get good ends. Secondly, we need to give thanks for Andy's life, his nature, his inquiring mind, his practical ways, his friendship, and indeed, while we're at St. George's, his faith. Because until he took sick and then ended up in Herberton, he was around there on a regular. I think we had a 90s pew there with Andy and Laurie Auction just about every Sunday. I knew started to get to know maybe 20 years ago when I started coming over to the river. So I judged him to be in the 60s. One Sunday he said to me, which really, I'm sorry I wasn't here last Sunday, I had to work. Perhaps he's a bit younger than I am. be cut. It has to be cut. You no practice or farmer, I assure you, we probably all knew that. But I still need you to be hopeful. What we are doing today is to wish our friend in the Aroha words which mean God be with him until we meet again and he has shed the confines of the earthly body, and we trust and hope and pray that he has inherited eternal life. Jesus promised us eternal, and after his resurrection, more than 500 people saw him again. Millions since then have prayed to Jesus and found their prayers unanswered. What can happen if he's dead? Psalm 23 paints a picture for us of the valley of the shadow of death. Not the valley of death, but a place where we will fear no evil. A place we will be shepherded by a loving God who will guide us, comforting us, and bring us to the place where his goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life. So we in faith say, follow on to beauty this morning and commend you to our loving, awesome God. Amen. Eulogies? Robert first.
His competitiveness was said this was for Albion. Andy regularly attended local Anglican church services where he held positions such as a church warden and committee member. Andy's last crop of tobacco was grown in the year 2000, 2 years before leaving the tobacco industry. He started growing asparagus. Whilst he had some good yields, diseases hit the crop, which made it unviable. So with much dismay, at the age of 84, he sold the farm and entered into retirement phase, buying a house on the edge of Mareeba.
At 77, tennis was becoming a bit strenuous for him. A few years later, he took up playing indoor bowls. There was some irony in this, as he always said he would never play bowls, as this was for, once again, old people. He soon came to love playing bowls, not only for the competition, but also for the social aspects. He unfortunately had to give it away after the ripe old age of 96 due to failing sight and a lack of stamina, having a few falls and sustained fractures. Andrew renewed his driver's licence in his 97th year, however he chose not to drive after that, even though his Ford Falcon was his pride and joy. Last year, Andy and Helen moved into a care facility in Herberton. Andy was still active right up to the end. Andy was a proud father, grandfather, great-grandfather, and will be remembered for his kindness, loyalty, telling good yarns, and being an avid Cowboys rugby league supporter. He was a passionate Cowboys fan and never missed a game on TV or radio. Andy was a huge advocate and supporter of his hometown, Mareeba, and was all for progress. If anything got in the road, look out. He was a life member of the Marine Radio Association. He served in the Volunteer Defence Corps from 1941 to 1945. Andy leaves behind his wife Helen and grown-up children Charles, Robert, myself and David, his grandchildren and great-grandchildren. He's with you, Dad, in a good place now.
It's amazing to think that Dad has been around for nearly 100 years. In that time, he experienced horse and buggies and ploughs, biplanes, early motor vehicles, living through the Great Depression and the war, and cyclones, etc. And then finally into the electronic technological age, of which he didn't ever really grasp. But I think from all of this, it made him appreciate and be proud of the simple things in life. Like his hometown of Mareeba, he was absolutely proud of his town. So much so, that when my family and I used to visit Mum and Dad, the first thing Dad did was pile us all into his prized Ford Falcon and show us every new house and business in the district and tell us everything that had happened since our last visit. So whilst I only wanted to have a relaxing holiday, I fully understood where he was coming from. Dad was a good family man and used to love taking us on family holidays and visiting historical places. I have great memories of us every year going to Clifton Beach for 2 weeks in the May holidays and staying at Hank's Hideaway units. There we'd play board games, go exploring, fishing and swimming in the ocean, and Dad would usually read a few Reader's Digest novels. One year, he packed us all into his Ford station wagon and we set off travelling around the Northern Territory for a couple of weeks, covering many thousands of kilometres. We'd stay in all sorts of places, with one of them being an old uranium mining town called Mary Kathleen. I was only 7 at the time, and if I remember correctly, all that was there was a hotel, a local store and some barracks for the workers. Here we stayed in a tin shed of some sort, and all night you could hear the roar from the hotel, which I'm sure never closed, and the drunks banging on our windows and the door, and poor Mum was sick with worry. But Dad had enough faith and trust in people that everything would be okay, and it was. And the next day we set off on our next adventure. In the 1980s, the Port Douglas Sheraton Mirage Luxury Resort and Golf Course was built. When we used to drive past it, my dad would say, "Wow, only the rich and famous stay there." Anyway, I made a vow that day that one day I'd take Mum and Dad there. So when Dad was about 90, a discount coupon came in the paper and all of our family stayed there for a couple of nights. Dad loved the luxurious beds, furniture and food, and especially enjoyed swimming in the continuous pools around the complex. So I can now say that Dad has mixed with the rich and famous. Another time I remember him talking about the rich and famous was when we used to watch the Love Boat series on television in the 1970s. On the boat, people were using electronic or electric toothbrush to clean their teeth. And Dad would say, "Look what the movie stars use." I don't know whether to this day he actually used one later on in life, and which, of course, we take them for granted these days. Dad was somebody who found it difficult to say no. If someone asked him to be on a committee, he would usually say yes, even if he had reservations about the job. Walking down the street, if somebody asked for a donation or gift to a course, he usually would. So it was good that he lived in the country and not in the city where he might have gone broke. Getting a job done around the house, he would trust the tradesmen, even if they gave a high quote. But of course, this would sometimes backfire on him. It seemed like his motto was, "If you can't trust anyone, life is meaningless." Dad was remarkably healthy for most of his life, and I hardly ever remember him being sick or not working. He must have had amazing healing properties because he survived incidents such as being sprayed with poison by a crop duster aircraft, healing in a couple of months after fracturing his pelvis at 97 years of age, and being bedbound by pneumonia when he was 98. I think he took his good health for granted because he would say, "I can't understand why people get sick." He was the last of his generation, and it seemed like he would go on forever. But of course, that can't happen. He remained relatively healthy right up to the end and was still walking around with the aid of a walking frame and playing skittles in the nursing home and, of course, always trying to win. Love you, Dad.
Love you, Granddad.
Good morning, families. This is Mary Charlotte Bryde in Bundaboo. To Helen and families, I can't tell you how sad I am at Andy's passing. He is my treasured cousin, and may he rest in peace. Love from Paul and Helen and families and myself.
Well, to introduce myself, I'm Marion, a niece of Uncle Andy's, and I'm sharing these few memories on behalf of Janice Page, my sister, and Erica Stockman, my cousin. We were Uncle Andy's only three nieces, that is, until Lexis Bryde arrived some 30-odd years ago. I've had to phone them to verify a few things, as most of this goes back to over 45 years ago. My mum, Kitty, was the eldest of the five, of which Uncle Andy was the middle child, so effectively she was like the matriarch. Mum and Dad bought a couple of acres of land from Uncle Andy back in about 1952 and settled just a kilometre from his house on Granite Creek. Uncle had a sizeable portion of land in those days, and from it another three farms were subdivided, one to his brother Eric, another to the Deacons, which later became Gatra's Farm, and the other was to Ken and Cole Royko. During the tobacco season, from a very early age, we spent a lot of time on the farm because Mum was one of the principal tobacco growers. We were pretty much left to our own devices to play. When we got older, we started stringing tobacco. Erica, Janice and I have lots of good memories of working sometimes 10-hour days, especially when the leaf was maturing fast and they had to get as much as possible off the plant. When times were slack, we'd build cubby houses and play games to while the time away in those sheds. We had a really good social time. And those same sheds hosted quite a few parties later in later years, including Janice's 21st. I think Uncle Andy was a very good farmer, probably something of a perfectionist, because he liked to do things well and he certainly wasn't a quitter. I remember that he got hit with hail twice in the same crop, and twice he cut those plants back by hand to allow the sucker to grow. His pride and joy was the John Deere tractor that he bought brand new, a lovely green and yellow one. And cars? Well, there only had to be one for him, and that was Ford. Always well looked after and maintained. Totally different to his sister Ev and Uncle Eric, who were both proud Holden owners. Uncle loved his tennis. He built an ant bed tennis court opposite Bates's house, about 200 metres from Tuco Road, and on the road leading to his farm. All the Bryde families and others gathered most Sundays for a social game of tennis. It must have had a big influence on us cousins, for most of us played tennis. Later he built the tennis court behind his tobacco sheds, and I can remember David hitting the ball up against the shed, because you could hear it from our place. Uncle often came to visit and have a couple with Mum and Dad. He helped Dad in many ways too, like felling the tree that was too close to the house. Another time he brought the tractor over to raise up the walls that Dad had built for a new section of the house. I'm sure there were lots of other times too. Janice remembers him driving the school bus when Uncle Jack was unable to do so, and Uncle Eric also helped out too. I bet none of them had an LR or HR driving license then. Uncle always looked 10 years younger than what he actually was. We remember Mum telling the story of Andy's indignation at being asked to leave the Mount Molloy pub by the police. He was on his way from Mossman to Mareeba at the time. They wouldn't believe him until he retrieved his license from the car and showed them. And I'll finish up by telling the story of Uncle Andy taking Janice and I fishing. He decided to take us below Royko's Weir, about a kilometre from his farm. We actually caught a few fish, jewfish, and all of a sudden a storm broke out of nowhere and drenched us. As we ran through the bush, the hook of my line got caught on a bush and unravelled behind us for a substantial distance. I can remember Uncle Andy being quite unamused and having to run back to wind up the line. And needless to say, he never asked us to go fishing again, but it was lovely of him to think of us and take us. So on that note, Erica, Janice and I wish to send our condolences to Auntie Helen, Charles, Robert, Noela and David and their respective families. And just to say that he'll always be remembered with fond affection. Thank you.
and just bow my hands in prayer. We say together in the old form and breath of Jesus for us to say, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
I think you're going to do a music out of this, hey?
Yeah.
Child of God and an inheritor of the kingdom of heaven at his baptism.